tuig. Eerst tilde ik een flatgebouw op. Er woonden 436 Turken in. Hun schoenen stonden bij de voordeur. Ik probeerde het gebouw rechtop te houden, zodat de inwonenden geen last zouden hebben van de verschoven zwaartekracht. Zo ben ik opgevoed. Toen tilde ik de Tippelstraat op. Ik rolde het om de Turkenflat heen. Helaas gleden er een paar transseksuele dames langs de ramen naar beneden. Ze riepen iets tegen me in het Spaans. Hartverscheurend. De metalen bankjes in de openbare ruimte schroefde ik met mijn blote handen los. Ik gooide ze op de hoop op mijn rug bij de gestolen fietsen, de daarbij horende daklozen, de thuislozen, de mensen die dwalen met reizen verwarden, de zelfmoordenaars, de treinrails, de lantaarnpalen en alle met graffiti bevlekte viaducten. Ik raapte de bugshack op. Alle tipjes van achtergelaten hashjoints, de restjes coke op de toiletpapierhouders en openbare toiletten, de aanstekers, de aanstichters, de vuurstichters, de zwervers, de brug waaronder ze sliepen, hun geïmproviseerde crackpijpen en handvol spuitjes, de eenzame gedrochten in seksbioscopen en alle kapot gelopen schoenen. Alles plakte aan elkaar van lichaamssappen. Mijn rug kraakte. De mensen bibberden. Omdat ik zo opgevoed ben, maakte ik een jas van de stroptassen van alle ongelukkige zakenmannen die ik op vrijdagavond van de straat geschraapt had. Ik bond de jas om de burgerslachtoffers. De taxichauffeurs, de nachtportiers, de schoonmakers, de slapeloze bijstandontvangers. Ik liet een enkele traan uit elk van hun ogen en ik droeg de straat die van mij was, omdat zij op mijn rug paste. Gieser Wildeman. Gieser Wildeman is een stoofbeer. Ik ben een vrouw. Dat is het dak van een 3 eeuwen oud huis. Ik ben een vrouw. Dat is het troebele vocht dat uit een Spaanse perzik langs zijn lippen loopt. En ik ben helaas het vocht en de perzik en elk ander handzaam, zacht, zoet, sappig fruit. Want ik ben een vrouw en dat is het brilmontuur van een man van gemiddelde intelligentie. Maar ik ben een vrouw en in mijzelf genoeg. Er is geen leegte in mij. Er is wel een schuilplaats, een voorkamer, een wachtruimte, een plek waar ik iemand kan ontvangen. Een man. Het begin van een kind, de vingers van een vrouw. Toch heb ik aan mezelf genoeg. Het maakt niet uit hoeveel postmoderne gendertheorie ik aan mijn heupen hang. Het is aan mij te zien. Ik ben een vrouw. Ik zou kunnen bestaan naast een man, maar een man is geen lichaam. Een man is geen brommende bastonen, geen lage stem, dikke armen, stroeve vingers, dikke huid, geen baard. Een man is geen baard. Een man is ook geen vage vuur. Een man is geen lot. Een man is geen huis om in te wonen. Een man is geen bed om op te liggen. Een man is geen werkverschaffing. Een man is geen afleiding. Een man is geen arbeidstherapie. Een man is geen raspaard. Een man is meer dan aanbiddende ogen in een gestolen nacht. Een man is geen kofferbak. Geen zwaailicht. Een man is geen diepe buiging voor mijn kruis. Een man heeft ook gevoelens. Denkt ook na. Heeft ook pijn. Soms weet hij zelfs waarom hij pijn heeft. Een man is geen vleeshaak, Geen fileermes, geen geweer, geen heet merkijzer, geen heilig boek, een man is geen wapen. Geen hobby. Een man is 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 geen strafregel. Een man is geen troon om met gekruiste benen op te zitten als een dame. Ik ben geen dame. Ik ben een vrouw.
I've got some very big shoes to fill after Radna Fabias. Thank you very much. Thank you to Rajmohan for the beautiful music. And welcome to you, ladies and gentlemen, to this opening night of Winternachten, Writers Unlimited Literary Festival. It's that time of the year. Best beginning of the year, isn't it? So like I said, this is the kickoff of 4 days of literature, free debate, polemics, hopefully some introspection, good music, cross-cultural talks, and interaction, all in good humor and safety. And the latter, the safety, seems more and more in danger now with the rise of political oppression that endangers free speech and free journalism. So tonight, we will be celebrating the free word and honoring those who stand by it and for it, firmly and proudly in the face of tyranny. And to do so, we will start with the director of the festival, Mr. Writers Unlimited, Tom van der Lankruis.
Thank you, Hassnae. Hassnae Bouazza is the host for tonight. Welcome you all. I prepared a speech and usually I read it aloud. And here it is. Well, we are here with a company of writers, poets, musicians. We have two laureates of the Oxfam Novib PEN Awards, and they are the main characters for tonight. And we have the Elderman for Culture of the City of The Hague, Robert van Asten, who will in a moment officially open this festival, although it's already running in that part, just nearby, where we have a spoken word evening. And we have our keynote speaker for tonight, who is Madeleine Thien from Canada. Welcome to you. Well, this is not just a literature festival like most literature festivals where writers promote their new books and read from it, and then we were happy to have seen them. This has been, for 24 years now, an event where we discuss international issues, social issues, with different perspectives, with writers from all over the world. It's a gift to The Hague, it's a gift to the Netherlands. We can be very happy to have these voices here. We do more than a festival, of course. Every month we have our programs in the Central Library. Coming year we'll have an exchange program with Turkey in collaboration with Germany and France. We'll host writers. In this festival, although you are here in the main venue, you must know that in all places, maybe 10 places in The Hague, we have programs, not only in the center, not only for what we call the educated elite who can afford tickets and feel welcome in places like this, but also in the libraries, cultural centers. We go to schools, we go to the university. We call that the outreach program. And that is a word that I had to learn in South Africa, because there were so many people who would never be able to pay for the bus ticket to go to a theater in the center. So what did they do in the literature festival in Durban, where they taught me, we go to them and we visit them because they need literature as much as we in the center need it. And that outreach program is growing and growing, and it's very successful. We have a theme this year, as always, and usually it's a song title. This time is Who Wants to Live Forever? We're going to sing in a moment. How did we get the theme? It was the Pakistani novelist, Mohsin Hamid. Those who were here last year must have seen him, must have marked him as a very good thinker. And as you may know, some may know, we always have closed sessions for the writers international writers, to give them the opportunity to meet, to get to know each other, to inspire each other. That's the writers' meeting. And at that meeting, at some point he said, we all want to live on in some way. Some pray to their gods for an eternal life. Others hope to live on through their children. And we writers, we are lucky because we hope to live on through our novels and poems. So, who wants to live forever? Where's the poster? Exactly, the poster expresses that, you know. It goes on and on, like, who wants to live? Anyone? Do you want to live forever? Is there anyone here? Hands, please. Only one. okay. Is there anyone? Oh, that's the second one. Is there anyone who would say, well, okay, but for a limited period of time? Yes, better. So I'd like to live longer. Is there anyone who would like to be forever young? Yes, that's the winner. You should see the program about Dorian Gray. There's a program where Dimitri Verhulst will personify Dorian Gray from Oscar Wilde's novel. He'll be on the couch of psychiatrist Damian Denis, and he'll tell you what happens if you want to be forever young. Those who know the novel know how it ends. If you want to know what it is to live forever, you should ask the gods. We have an Indian specialist on that, the writer Ashia Sattar. She will tell you everything about that because all the questions seem to have been answered in Indian mythology. So at some point in the discussion, she will say, well, if you want to know the real answer to the question, I'll just read this for you. There's another choice, and that is to live long, to leave the choices to computer algorithms. And then the computer will give you the answer to all your questions about eternal life. We made a program on that, and it is called Artificial Ignorance. Now, how dark or light will the future be? Because if you want to live forever, or you want to be forever young, you will probably go into a future that you don't know anything about. Will you fear the future, or do you look forward to it? Anyone who looks forward to the future, hands, please. Okay, any fear for the future, anxiety for the future? It's even, and a lot of that is in between. Okay, well, you will hear dystopias and utopias from our writers, written for the occasion. We had assignments for the poetry and for the prose writers. We even have a program that's called Thinking of Holland Fast Forward. And the Dutch among you know what I mean, Thinking of Holland. Denkend aan Holland is one of a very famous poem by Henk Marsman. Well, let's not talk about the EU to determine our future or Britain. But we will have a program on the future of the EU with the Polish poet Adam Zagajewski, David van Rijbroek and Luc van Middelaar. That's on Saturday afternoon. And of course, we have the books. If you want answers, or you want the better questions, read the books. Our writers will all present their favorite books. There's a special program on Friday and Saturday night, but one writer, especially Ian Buruma, will introduce three of his favorite books to you, and he speaks all the languages, Japanese, English, German. He'll tell you which books to read. Now, it's time to thank all those people who made this festival happen. More than 100 writers, the City of The Hague, the Dutch Foundation for Literature, and our sponsors. We have a foundation, Friends of Writers Unlimited. Please join them. And all the partner organizations in the city and outside. And we have a team. We have two teams making this festival. There's the artistic team, led by Shervin Nekewe. This is his third year. And we have the production team, led by Tineke van Maan. And I want to thank those two especially and their teams. Finally, before I give the floor to our Elderman for Culture, Robert van Aster, to open this festival, I beg the writers and poets, please give us your views on the future. Make yourselves immortal through your words. You can help us because mortals as we are all running out of time. As the song says, there's no time for us. There's no place for us. What is this thing that fills our dreams and slips away from us? Who wants to live forever? Who wants to live forever? Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I won't be singing after this beautiful intermezzo. But I too would like to welcome you here to this first evening of Winternachten Festival. A special edition because it's the 24th edition. We're already looking forward to next year. And we find literature important here in The Hague. And this festival is proof of that. Language is an incredibly important part of human life. That is why we promote reading in The Hague and why we fight illiteracy. What's important is that people learn that reading can be fun and that they become acquainted with books and writers that appeal to them. This applies to young people as well as old and for all social classes, of course. Moreover, reading is extremely relaxing and it stimulates the imagination. Reading a book also offers you insight into the different personalities of the characters in that book, which can help you to deal with others. Reading helps you to shape your thoughts, to verbalize ideas, to convey your opinion. This leads to exchange, and exchange is essential for developing a lasting understanding of others. Of course, The Hague, city of peace and justice, and the political heart of the country is extremely proud of hosting this festival. In the next few days, you'll be able to listen to writers, poets, and philosophers. Sorry. And you will meet them and be able to engage in a dialogue. In other words, you will be immersed in everything the literary world has to offer. Thank you very much to Writers Unlimited for organizing this festival, a festival which over the years has fostered, yes, guaranteed special encounters and introductions. I wish you all very inspiring days. Thank you.
Truth will come to light. Murder cannot be hid long.
That was chilling, right? I think silence is the only real answer or correct answer to see all those names of people who gave their lives unwillingly because of the work that they do. What we just witnessed is the digital unveiling of the digital monument for killed writers and journalists. From 1992 on, CPJ, the Committee to Protect Journalists, and PEN International have kept count of each murdered writer and journalist in the world. And so far, they have recorded over 1,700 names. It is a sad fact that in 2018, the number of journalists targeted for murder has, in reprisal of their reporting activities, almost doubled within the space of 1 year. The digital monument is a tribute to these courageous writers and journalists who sacrificed their lives for the free word. The clip was made by a theater of wrongdoing decisions. It's a collective of artists who react to current burning issues of moral concern. And by using Shakespearean quotes, they put these issues into a universal perspective. This video was made by Ruud Hisgen, Ingrid Rollema, and Erik de Vries, and they're in the room. So would you please stand up? Ruud, Ingrid, and Erik, yes. Thank you for a very impressive piece of art that honors people. I have a very sad note to add. Today we learned that yesterday Ahmed Hussein Suwala was killed in Accra, Ghana. He was a member of a research team that investigated corruption in football. So yet another name, and the year has only just begun. On that note, on that very sad note, I would like to invite Jennifer Clement, writer and director of PEN International. Please give her a very warm welcome. I'm just gonna admit that I was so impressed with the video that I forgot to bring along the mic, so please excuse me for that. Yeah. We're all humans, we all make mistakes. Hopefully not as awful mistakes as the people who run countries and who target journalists.
Sorry, was that a question?
I said we're all humans and we all make mistakes, but hopefully not as bad mistakes as the leaders, political leaders who target journalists and writers.
I don't think it's a mistake that they are making. I think it's intentional.
Yeah. And how does, so we saw the film, the clip, and we saw the names, and what is that, how does that make you feel as, you know, a fervent defender of free speech?
Well, the thing that I always say is that one thing about being in PEN that's such a great privilege is that every day of our lives we are working for the bravest people in the world. These are people that risk their life, their livelihood, their families, their homeland to tell the truth.
Yeah.
And we need this more than ever before, it seems. So these organizations are very important, and prizes like these are very important.
Yeah. Are these challenging times, extra challenging times, because of the, you know, the changing political climate?
They seem to be. Mm-hmm. We may look back at the 80s and 90s as kind of a golden age of freedom of expression. I mean, it's very worrisome what we're seeing everywhere.
Yeah, and I think we saw his name, Jamal Khashoggi. I think that was the most high-profile case because of the absurdity of what happened.
Well, I actually talk about it a little bit in my speech. Not just the absurdity, it's complex on so many levels because of the pre-planned by a state, then supported by other states. There has been no consequences. So it certainly stands out as one of the worst cases last year.
Okay, yeah. So I'll let you to it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. It's a privilege to be here tonight with Madeleine Thien, with Ton Van Lancruis, the director of Writers Unlimited, and Farah Karimi, and Michiel Servaes from Oxfam Novib. I will never forget the first year I stood here, where not a single recipient of the award was present. Two were in jail, the Turkish journalist Chandundar and Eritrean poet, journalist, and editor-in-chief Emmanuel Asrat, whose fate is still unclear 16 years after his arrest. An Egyptian poet, Omar Hazek, whose passport was taken as he tried to board a flight in Cairo to come to this ceremony. In October 2017, I went to Israel with PEN International's executive director, Carles Torner, to visit the Palestinian poet, Dareen Tatour, who was under house arrest awaiting trial for a poem she'd written and posted on social media called "Resist, My People, Resist Them." On that day, I never imagined I'd be here tonight with her by my side, along with the Nicaraguan poet, novelist, and journalist, Gioconda Belli, who has spoken out courageously against President Daniel Ortega's
tyrannical oppression. So often the recipients of the Oxfam Novib PEN Award cannot be here, and this is the case tonight for the Italian journalist and anti-mafia author Roberto Saviano, who lives most of his life in hiding, fearful of assassination. Today, some 200 Italian journalists live under police protection for fear of reprisals simply for carrying out their work as journalists. The award we're giving tonight at this important festival where the word is celebrated acknowledges the extraordinary bravery of those who write and speak truth to power in spite of great danger. This past year alone, thousands of writers have lived in peril, been forced into exile, have been jailed unjustly, and even been killed. Too many have lost their lives to name here tonight, and 2018 was by far one of the worst years ever for writers and journalists. Nevertheless, I believe there is one case I must mention in this space tonight because he will never stand here. I cannot imagine that any one of us can ever forget the video of Jamal Khashoggi entering the Saudi consulate in Istanbul and the hopeful steps he took from dreams of marrying the woman he loved toward his brutal murder. Outside the consulate, his fiancée waited for 10 hours, getting increasingly more frantic, but he never came out. She said these words over and over again. He never came out. He never came out. Those 10 hours belong to all of us now. Justice and mercy are missing for so many. It is therefore both humbling and an honor to be here at the presentation of this award for freedom of expression and to stand with these courageous women who at great personal risk and sacrifice try to change things for the better for us all. Thank you. And I'm very proud to present Madeleine Thien.
After the death of Mao Zedong in 1976 and the end of the Cultural Revolution, Zhang Xianling, an aerospace engineer, settled in Beijing. She married Wang Fandi, a musician, and together they raised their only child, a son, Wang Nan. On the night of June 3, 1989, Wang Nan, still in high school, went out to photograph the massacre on the roads and streets leading to Tiananmen Square. He wished, his mother said, to document history. Around 1 a.m., Wang Nan was shot by government soldiers. He was denied medical attention and human comfort for 3 hours as he lay dying. For 10 days, his parents searched for him, returning again and again to 24 different hospitals. When Zhang Xianling finally located her son's body, which had been sent, she was told, to a small unknown hospital because Beijing's mortuaries were full, she was given a paper receipt written with the words, shot outside and died. A year later, Zhang met Ding Zilin, a professor of philosophy who had been a member of the Communist Party for 32 years and whose 17-year-old son had also been killed on the night of June 3rd. The two women founded the Tiananmen Mothers. Their first request was simple, the right to mourn peacefully in public. Today, nearly 30 years since the massacre, all mention of the 6 weeks of demonstrations in Tiananmen Square and the killing of civilians by the government is illegal. Private commemoration in one's own home is prosecuted as a crime. On Chang'an Avenue, the Avenue of Eternal Peace, a single surveillance camera watches the precise location where Wang Nan died. This camera is meant for his parents alone, a reminder to them that public mourning is forbidden. Mourning, we might believe, is part and parcel of ordinary life. How perfectly ordinary it seems to want to lay flowers in the place where a loved one died. I often think how unsettling it is that in a universe that is 13.8 billion years old, we live only this minuscule flickering present. Perhaps mourning is love extended in space and time, a love that extends to the soil, the sky, the objects, the books that made contact with a now vanished existence. Wang Nan lived for 19 years. Grief for the dead of Tiananmen, wrote the poet Lu Xiaobo in 2004, and grief for those accused of fabricated crimes is memory's nakedness under a regime that forces one to desperateness. In 2008, on the 60th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Liu Xiaobo, along with 300 Chinese citizens, including Ding Zilin and Zhang Xianling, released Charter 08, asking the government to uphold its own constitution and the Human Rights Convention to which China is a signatory. Liu Xiaobo was detained on suspicion of collecting signatures for the charter. After a year of solitary confinement, he was convicted of inciting subversion to state power and sentenced to 11 years in prison. In 2010, when he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, his wife, the poet Liu Xia, was placed under house arrest, although she had never been accused of any crime. She would remain in custody for 8 years. When her husband died on July 13, 2017, the first Nobel Peace Prize laureate to die in custody since Karl von Ossietzky died under Gestapo surveillance in 1938, she was not allowed to bring his body back to Beijing. Instead, the government arranged his funeral. Surrounded by officials, security agents, and government photographers, Liu Xia, forbidden from contacting friends and loved ones, was forced to watch in silence as her husband's ashes were deposited in the sea. I do not feel guilty, Liu Xiaobo wrote in 2009, for following my constitutional right to freedom of expression, for fulfilling my social responsibility as a Chinese citizen. Since arriving in this world, Ding Zilin wrote, I only wanted to live an ordinary life. Ordinariness appears to be so commonplace, so conventional, that perhaps we forget how elusive it remains. To love, to grieve a death, to befriend, to be both enthralled and frightened of this universe of ours, to have faith or give up faith, to live in dignity. All this seems so ordinary as to be entirely unremarkable. Scientists say that we are born into a planet for which we were made. Our lungs, hands, and feet, our minds. For over 100,000 years, Homo sapiens have been evolving on this earth. We evolved to survive here, and perhaps in no other place in this unimaginably vast universe whose observable space is 93 billion light years in diameter. Between the seeming infinity of past and future, Hannah Arendt wrote, we live in a tiny crevice of time. This is the ground on which we stand, although, she observed, sometimes it seems to be a battlefield and not a home. She wrote of Amor Mundi and the desire to love the world enough to take responsibility for it, and called our grasping towards knowledge the specifically human way of being alive, for every single person needs to be reconciled to a world into which they were born a stranger. This contradiction, that we were all born into a world a stranger, but that we all nevertheless belong only here, is at the focal point of our art and stories, our politics and governance, our births and deaths. What can we know and how shall we act in this world in which we are both intimate and alien, a world in which even the most ordinary things never exactly repeat? Over 300 years ago, Benedict Spinoza wrote his Tractatus Theologico-Politicus. In it, he made the bold statement that the state exists to support the purpose of our lives, which he asserted to be freedom of inquiry. Spinoza's treatise, published in 1670, 1 year after his friend Adrian van Korbach was arrested for blasphemy and died in prison, was soon banned. I have made a ceaseless effort, wrote Spinoza in the Tractatus, not to ridicule, not to bewail, not to scorn human actions, but to understand them. He believed free inquiry was the path to human well-being and even flourishing, our only means to differentiate between servility and freedom. The ultimate aim of government, Spinoza wrote, is to enable people to develop their mental and physical faculties in safety, to use their reason without restraint, and to refrain from the strife and vicious mutual abuse that is prompted by hatred, anger, or deceit. The ultimate purpose of the state is, in reality, freedom. In the fall of 2018, Jamal Khashoggi was told by Saudi officials that the divorce papers he needed in order to remarry could not be obtained in Washington, D.C., where he lived. Instead, he would need to travel to Turkey to apply for and receive these documents. Paperwork required for ordinary life, the bureaucracy that twists through love, family, belonging, citizenship, was used by Khashoggi's own government to lure him to his death. On September 28, he was told to return on October 2, 2018 at 1 p.m. to collect his documents. That day, Khashoggi's fiancée, Hatice Cengiz, waited outside the Saudi consulate in Istanbul. There was shopping to be done in the afternoon, and in the evening they planned to celebrate their engagement with family and close friends. She stood waiting until 1 a.m. Our visit to the consulate was full of hope, wrote Cengiz. We were going to get the official paper, and we were going to get married and continue the rest of our lives together. His body has not been recovered. In all likelihood, he will never be returned to his loved ones. Khashoggi's son, Salah, said he wanted to bury his father in Medina with his family. We just need to make sure that he rests in peace. A son wishing to bury his father, a couple who have found happiness together, the most basic things. When asked why she persisted in confronting the government, the Tiananmen mother, Jiang Xianling, said, I slowly traveled out of my own personal pain, and I channeled this pain into a kind of bravery for finding the truth. She and Ding Zilin became the first Chinese citizens still living inside China to go public with the specific details of Tiananmen deaths. Decades later, when the writer Louisa Lim asked Zhang how she imagined mourning her son, Zhang answered, I'd like to go to the place where he died at 8 or 9 in the evening. If no one were watching me, I'd go at night. I'd pour some liquor onto the ground. Then I'd scatter white flower petals there on the earth. During the siege of Beirut in the summer of 1982, Mahmoud Darwish famously counted the time between exploding shells, only a single second, he observed, between explosions. I want the aroma of coffee, he wrote in his poem, Hiroshima Day. I need 5 minutes. I want a 5-minute truce for the sake of coffee. I have no personal wish other than to make a cup of coffee. The aroma of coffee so I can hold myself together, stand on my feet, and be transformed from something that crawls into a human being. Darwish, stubbornly reminding us what is private, what is pleasurable, what is quotidian, what is ours, belongs to Spinoza's freedom of inquiry. His poem does not ask why simple things have become unobtainable. It simply notes this fact, the fact of what it is to be expelled from the circle of the ordinary, the familiar, the fact of life in a temporary home, in an existence derided as alien. In a poem written in memory of Edward Said, he writes, is the impossible far? And in this poem, he asks, but how to reach the kitchen? We are in uncertain times. Asking questions of any orthodoxy is increasingly unacceptable, even in places we imagine to be free. And for some, even many, access to what others might consider ordinary or even banal is forbidden. Across the political spectrum, fear has mixed with scorn. We seem to insist on and even take pride in our atomization and to deny our contingency, our brevity, our shared future. But if we are not free to hear divergent points of view, we are not free. It is hard, if not impossible, to know what to say in the presence of those who risk their lives so that we may all collectively be free. It is hard, I must confess, to look them in the eye. Perhaps in naming them, we are trying to rouse ourselves from our own slumber. All happiness or unhappiness, wrote Spinoza in the Ethics, depends upon the quality of the object to which we are attached by love. Sorry. Love of the world for Spinoza was love of nature and love of God. Love for many of us, love for the world, is intertwined with the love of language. To know if we can name things and thereby see them and thereby follow the line connecting each to each. Let us go as we are, Darwish wrote in his poem, we were without a present. Let us go together on our separate paths. Let us go as we are, separately and as one. The poet and novelist Khun Srun, murdered in December 1978 during the Cambodian genocide, found kinship with the novels of Yasunari Kawabata and Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Khun's last book, The Accused, was written during the horrific American bombing of his country. He was bewildered by his desire to write about beauty, about the disappearing every day. Considered a traitor by all sides, Khun saw himself as a citizen. Critique was born of grief, of mourning. It was born of love. Before the war consumed him, Khun wrote, I think of my writing desk, the armoire I would open to take out my books, the chair on which I would sit. I think of my family, my friends, my loved ones. I think of asphalt roads, running water, the radio, the television, all the beautiful songs we listen to. I remember everything. Khun knew that his life, and therefore his literature, were born from the soil of the everyday, the essential rawness of existence which creates wonder and renders wonder into the ordinary again, back and forth eternally. I think he would have loved the Czech writer Bohumil Hrabal and his unending endings. I was glad the villagers had come all that way through the snow to see me, Hrabal wrote in I Served the King of England, glad they'd been alarmed by me because I must be something rare. How perfectly ordinary are the repetitive, mundane flourishes in the traditional songs that gather communities together, in the tales, fables, and great literary works whose descriptions enchant us with their intricate simplicity. We see that we need simplicity in order to reach the stairs of transcendence, which embrace, I hope, love for life and are still to be imagined every day. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madeleine Thien. That was a wonderful tribute to very courageous people. And let me just say that I really appreciated the sincerity of your words, because we do tend to forget that below the surface of courage and the struggle is the intimacy of pain and sorrow for loved ones. So thank you for that. And it is indeed very humbling to be here in the presence of, you know, courageous people who I, you know, I can't stand in your shadows, let that be clear. But I do have a mic this time, so I didn't forget it. We live and learn. And I would like to invite a director of Oxfam Novib, Michiel Servaes, to the stage. Give him a warm welcome. If you'll join me for a second.
Sure.
So, Michiel, this is your first time here as a director of Oxfam Novib.
Absolutely.
And so how's the vibe here?
The vibe? Well, yeah. I mean, I'm as emotional as she was now. It's impressive to be here.
to hear this, these personal stories. And I must say, I mean, the events at Tiananmen Square for people from my generation in that bizarre year of 1981, I was a 17-year-old high school kid then, you know, they were, for me personally, the inspiration to do what I'm doing now. I wanted to go to university to study science in Delft, but I went for international relations and political science because I wanted to be part of, you know, the fight for freedom, basically.
Yeah, and you're continuing the fight for freedom at Oxfam Novib?
Absolutely, yeah. No, I mean, this is the essence of the organization, right? So fighting against inequality, against poverty, and against injustice. And that is the essence of tonight, I would say.
Yeah, so we talked about some of the casualties that fell early last year and this year. And today we learned that the Dutch journalist Ans Boersma was deported. I mean, it's a big word, but she was sent away from Turkey without documents on the suspicion of terrorism. So what do you think of that?
I think I was as surprised as so many people were today, and even I'm sure all our international guests didn't get all the details of the news today. It's confusing, right? Because we heard that she was kicked out of Turkey, basically, and then later the public prosecutor's office here in the Netherlands announced that she was part of some sort of investigation. But I was so surprised because the Dutch government should know, and I'm sure they do know, how vulnerable you are as a journalist in Turkey these days. And whatever is the circumstances from the legal criminal investigation point of view, we know how vulnerable these people are. So they better have some good answers to the questions that were raised today.
Yeah, and I'm sure you'll be following that up.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I'm going to give you the floor
to
announce the winners.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I think we have to adjust this a little bit, right? Yeah. Yeah, that's fine. Thanks. Hello, everybody. It's fantastic to be here. As was said, it's my first time. I've been the director of Oxfam Novib only for 3.5 months. I've been a citizen of the city of The Hague for 9.5 months, and I'm equally happy with that on an evening such as tonight. But it is from the 24 times I heard tonight, the 18th time already that Oxfam Novib is handing out this prize together with PEN International. And I was happy to be part. Actually, it was the first time I was invited to participate in a board of directors meeting at Oxfam Novib to be part of the selection process of the final prize winners that we're honoring tonight. And we chose them very consciously, I must say. The three prize winners are from three continents and are equally special, I would say. The first one, who could not be here today, is actually the first European winner ever of one of these awards. And in a way, it's a sad sign of the times, isn't it? It is a testament to what is happening in Europe at the moment, developments that are very worrying, developments that we see in countries such as Hungary, Poland, but also in Italy. Where the room for critical voices, for critical journalists, writers, is shrinking all the time. But I do think it is important for us to realize also that oppressed writers, oppressed critics, killed writers and journalists is not something from far away, from strange dictatorial countries. It is here. So it's a big warning to all of us, I would say. The second prize winner is from Latin America, from Nicaragua, the country of Nicaragua. And it is a country that we would really like to put the spotlights on here in the Netherlands and in Europe. I'm not sure how many of you are actually aware of the developments in that country. Since April last year, 325 people have been killed in Nicaragua. More than 1,200 activists, social leaders, and journalists have been kidnapped and imprisoned, and 60,000 people have fled to neighboring countries. Human rights organizations, including some that Oxfam in Nicaragua is supporting, are being closed so that these violations can actually no longer or much more difficult be recorded. It is fair to say that Nicaragua is facing one of the most serious political crises in its history. And where is the global outcry? What do we know of this situation? What do we know of the situation in other Latin American countries where the room for these critical voices is shrinking tremendously? I feel a very strong responsibility here representing Novib, an organization that has a tradition of supporting opposition voices in Latin American countries in a time in the 1970s, 1980s. I didn't live through those times very consciously, but was very actively and publicly supporting those opposition figures. And I think the Netherlands was one of those countries where this really resonated. And my hope would be that we would do the same again. And we're starting tonight. The third prize is special for two reasons, I would say. So it's special because of the winner and the situation where she is doing her work. But I have to add, being here as the new director for Oxfam Novib, that this prize is special for another reason, because when Farah Karimi, my predecessor, was leaving the organization after more than 11 years, they asked her, what would you like to have as a present? A nice piece of art or some books or whatever. But she said, no, I would like to have an extra prize tonight. I would like to honor especially courageous women in the Middle East, in this region where it's so difficult to stand up against regimes anyway, but especially for women. And in your honor, Farah Karimi, we hand out this prize tonight. And I would like to have a round of applause for that. So big pressure on us to select someone special for this prize. And we found someone, a great poet that tries to defend the free world in one, I think it's fair to say, of the most complicated and polarized regions of the world, living as a Palestinian in Israel. Especially in the last few years, the Israeli government has systematically increased the pressure on critical people, human rights organizations, and curtailed the freedom of speech. Even Dutch organizations were targeted only this year. In the summer, our colleagues from SOMO were refused entry into Israel because of a report that they published, the money trail. And other Dutch organizations, including Oxfam Novib, were falsely accused of subsidizing the so-called BDS, the boycott movement there. It's extremely worrying to see that. We've seen legislation being introduced where NGOs are now called foreign agents. We've seen it in many countries. But also legislation is proposed for a law which would actually limit the freedom of speech of cultural organizations and artists. And there was a big demonstration I heard in Tel Aviv against this law with many speakers. And then I like to take one line that was said there by one of the speakers, which I think is the essence of what's so wrong about this law. One speaker said, "The desire to tame the art in a law is so foolish, but more than that, it's also evil. And even more than that, it is doomed to fail. Because to want loyalty in culture is to change the DNA of art, of creativity, and of life itself." And that is very powerful. So even if this law would be introduced, forget it. Culture will be culture, and we'll always look for freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the pleasure of announcing three winners for tonight. I think you heard their names already, but anyway, let me build up some sort of tension. And I will start with the person that unfortunately cannot be here, Roberto Saviano from Italy. As I said, our first European Prize winner. You might know him for his bestseller, Gomorrah, about the Italian mafia, which was published in 2006. And since that time already, he has been receiving police protection. But when the Italian government came to power, the current Italian government, and started this extremely harsh right-wing anti-migration policies, he became a critic of that government as well, and called the minister of the underworld. And then the minister not only sued him for that, but he threatened to take away his protection. This is Western Europe, ladies and gentlemen. And in fact, when we selected him for this prize, we had many difficulties in reaching him, which is a demonstration of how tight this protection is. But fortunately, he was informed in time that he received the prize, and I understand that some words by him will be read to you later. Then, second prize, as I said, situation in Nicaragua. We're extremely happy to have Gioconda Belli here tonight, a world-renowned poet. Please. I think you can actually come to the stage. I'm not sure what the exact choreography is, but I will keep talking. A world-renowned poet and writer, and actually also president of PEN Nicaragua, so very much part of the PEN family. She and several other members of the center were accused of terrorist conspiracy in May in an attempt to discredit and intimidate them. But I'm extremely happy that you are here tonight. I heard you were already on Dutch radio tonight, so you're spreading the news about the situation in your country. So great to have you here. And then the third special prize winner today here is Dareen Tatour, please. I think you already heard the story that she was actually in prison just a few years ago. She gave me a present tonight, which is bizarre because we are here to honor her, but she gave me a book of Jerusalem, which is her city. So I shared with her how beautiful this city indeed is, but she told me it is, but I can't go there. She still can't travel there to East Jerusalem, not to Palestine, not to her own country, but I'm happy that you are here tonight. We know about the poem that was the whole reason for the Israeli government to try to prosecute you. But I repeat your words here, and I think these are my final words as well. Poetry is not a crime. Thank you so much.
So we will be hearing from the winners in a few moments. But first, I would like to share with you Roberto Saviano's message that he sent to us. He writes, "I am very grateful to Oxfam Novib and PEN for awarding me this Freedom of Expression Prize. I'm grateful because nowadays we tend to take freedom of expression for granted. Yet it is a precious asset to be defended every day. In the Europe of Daphne Caruana Galizia, in the Europe of Jan Kuciak, we know that writing is not an easy job. We know that we can be threatened and die for an article or a report. Today we know that freedom of expression does not mean that everyone has the possibility of expressing their thoughts on social media. It means not being vulnerable anymore when talking about the mechanisms of power, when disclosing, for instance, links between politics and criminal organizations. We can only defend freedom of expression by drawing attention to it, which is what you are doing here today." Roberto Saviano. And up next, we have some music by singer, poet, and composer Raj Mohan. Give him a warm welcome. There he is. Thank you, Raj Mohan. That was a poem in Hindi inspired by the Song of the Birds. And now it is time for Dareen's word of thanks. Dareen, tfaddali.
Masa al khair, good evening. حاولوا قتلي نفسيا وخرس هذا الصوت إلا أن الشعر انطلق وتحرر وتحدى الظلم وأبى أن يكون سجينا مع جسد الشاعرة تخطى الحدود حتى وصل إليكم وجعلني أقف هنا بينكم وأستلم هذه الجائزة القوة الحقيقية تكمن بكم وبإصراركم ووقفتكم وتحديكم معي للظلم أنا الآن معكم أشعر بمعنى الحرية الحقيقية أشعر أنني انتصرت على الاحتلال. هذا الشرف وهذه الجائزة التي كرمتموني بها ليست لي، إنها لكل إنسان ناضل معي في قضية الشعر المتهم والخطير وقصة الشاعرة الفلسطينية المعتقلة بالسجون الإسرائيلية. أقف هنا أمامكم عاجز عن إيجاد الكلمات تليق بوقفتكم معي كشاعرة. اعتقلت، سجنت، حكمت لثلاث سنوات متتالية، وما زلت مطاردة من قبل السلطات الإسرائيلية فقط لمجرد أنني كتبت قصيدة تحكي عن وجعنا نحن الفلسطينيون من الاحتلال. وقوفي هنا معكم واستلامي لهذه الجائزة هو الرد على سياسة تكميم الأفواه، فشكرا لكم. الشكر لشعب الفلسطيني الذي يعاني من الاحتلال والحواجز وجدار الفصل العنصري والقتل وحصار غزة وهدم البيوت ومصادرة الأراضي وحق التعبير عن الرأي. الشكر لروح الشهيد الطفل علي دوابشي وعائلته، ولروح الشهيد الطفل محمد أبو خضير، ولروح الشهيدة هديل الهشلمون، لأنهم من ألهموني كتابة قصيدة قاوم التي أوصلت صوت شعري لكم وجعلتني أقف معكم هنا وأستلم الجائزة. الشكر لأمي وأبي، الشكر لأصدقائي. Thank you.
تفضلي. So Dareen flew from Tel Aviv, and we were wondering what that experience was like. Dareen, جئت من تل أبيب. كيف كانت التجربة بالمطار؟
مجرد أنه وصلت على المطار حسيت حالي أني موجودة في السجن مباشرة، مرة أخرى بالسجن، مرقة تحقيق مجدد، تفتيش جدا قاسي، كأني بالسجن مرة أخرى. حتى كل أغراضي طبعا مرقة تفتيش بشكل خاص، وأسئلة جدا دقيقة لكل إشي بسويه، وين رايحة، مع مين أجيتي، كيف جيتي، ولوين رايحة، لدرجة إنه وصلت لمرحلة التفتيش العاري في قلب المطار. فعمليا أنا كنت في، وصلت للمطار وصلت كأني بالسجن تماما. إيش الأشياء اللي مرقتها في السجن مرقتها في المطار.
Entering the airport was like entering prison. It was this, it felt the same as when I actually entered prison. They investigated me, they searched me, they searched everything, they questioned me in detail. They even went so far as to strip search me in the middle of the airport. So it really felt like a prison. But they actually imprisoned you. So what was it like that, you know, being in a room a couple of meters and not being able to leave? كيف كانت تجربة داخل السجن الاعتقال؟
السجن طبعا بحد ذاته جدا صعب كان. مرقت باشياء كثير قاسيه. منعوا علي كل شيء، حتى تبديل ملابسي، ادخال ملابس لإلي منعوها علي، لدرجه انه قعدت 21 يوم في التحقيق وفي الزنازين. كل كنت اعمله انه كنت اطلب اغير ملابسي، رفضوا يدخلوا لي ملابس. كل اللي عملته انه كنت اغسل حتى ملابسي والبسها وهي رطبه. كان في فترة التحقيقات كان تعذيب نفسي أكثر، يحطوا لي في غرفة فيها يسلطوا فيها المكيفات الباردة، لدرجة أنه كنت أحس أنه أنا موجودة في ثلاجة موتى.
Prison was very hard. I spent that 21 days without the possibility to change my clothes. 21 days of interrogation. They didn't allow me to, you know, change clothes, so I had to wash them and put them on wet, and that was very hard. They tortured me psychologically, mentally, and they put me in sort of a freezer cell, the same sort of freezer cell that they put corpses in. But were you able to write poetry in prison? كان بإمكانك تكتبي شعر بالسجن؟
للأسف لا. بالبداية طبعاً طلبت، أول ما وصلت السجن الشيء الوحيد إنه وصلت لمرحلة إنه بدي أكتب بأي طريقة، طلبت ورقة وقلم، فقالوا لي، كان جوابهم إنه أنت بالذات ممنوع عليك القلم والورقة. فوصلت لمرحلة إنه مش قادرة أتحمل أكثر السجن، بدي أكتب أكثر شيء بدي أعمله، بدي أكتب. فكان في، بلشت ادور على وسيله انه اكتب فيها باي طريقه، ما لقيتش غير سحاب الجاكيت تبعت مصلحه السجون، فقمت السحاب وبلشت اكتب الشعر على الجدران الزنزاني.
The first thing that I asked him was you know, a pen and pencil to write poetry, and they told me that I, of all people, was not allowed to have a pen. And I felt this huge urge to write poetry, and I couldn't, so I started to think of a way to write poetry. So what I did is I used the zipper of the clothes that I had on, and I wrote the poetry on the walls of the prison cell. So now we will hear two of your poems. Shukran. Okay, so she will share it with you. Shukran.
من في الحبس؟ أنا صبر، أنا يأس، ومع صبري ومع يأسي يصير الشوك مفتاحا لباب السجن. أنا لحن، أنا دمع، أنا حبر، أنا حرفي، أنا لغتي. ومن حبري ومن دمعي يفيق الصبح. أنا شعر على الجدران محفور بضوء الشمس. أنا حب وأشواقي مكبلة يحاصرني وداع الأمس. ولكني برغم القيد أرى الميلاد والملقى وذي حرية الأبقى ترى في الحس. أنا عدم، أنا كل، أنا الأشياء واللا شيء هنا في السجن. في زنزانتي عتم ولكني أرى الأضواء في قلبي وذي حريتي نور فمن في الحبس؟ أنا صوت له ظل، أنا السجان والمسجون والسجن، أنا القهار والمقهور والقهر، أنا الظلام والمظلوم والظلم، أنا الإنسان. أنا موج بوسط البحر قد أغرق، أنا نار بنار مثلها أحرق، أنا وطن ولي وجهان، وجه ضاحك باك ووجه من بكى يضحك، وفي نبضي عصافير تغني اللحن والأشعار لا تصمت، فمن في الحبس؟ حريتي. غلقوا علي الباب في زنزانة، شدوا الإثارة وأحكموا إقفالها، منعوا دخول النور زادت ظلمة فرسمت مصباحا على جدرانها، مسحوا الجدار يراعتي قد صادروا فتوهجت شمس العيون بليلها، عصبوا العيون كذا لساني كمموا فأنار شعري في الفؤاد ظلامها، أشعلت في روحي فتيل مشاعري فأضاء فانوس القصائد عتمها، إن قيدت تلك السلاسل معصمي لن يسجنوا حس الحياة بحسها. حريتي، 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 لن يقتلوا في الشعور بحسها.
Thank you, Dareen. Shukran, Dareen. And I think we can all say, inshallah, ameen, amen to your freedom. And another amen to another woman's freedom, Gioconda Belli. Gioconda, please.
Thank you so much. This is really a lot of emotion. I come to you from the nightmarish experience of seeing my country mauled once again by the jaws of tyranny. In the last month, freedom of expression has suffered very severe blows in Nicaragua. Two of our most important independent media standard bearers have been viciously attacked. Carlos Fernando Chamorro was once the director of the Sandinista newspaper Barricada. He parted ways with Daniel Ortega and the FSLN in the 90s and began publishing an independent newsletter, Confidencial, and producing two TV shows, This Week and Tonight. At dawn on December 19th, police forces broke into his office building, vandalized its contents, and carried away his most essential equipment. That same night, with no court order, they took possession of the building and everything in it. They have remained inside the premises since then. On December 21st, a TV station, 100% News, was also overrun by riot police, boarded up, taken off the air, and both its director and owner and its news editor were taken prisoner, charged with absurd accusations, such as inciting hate. They are now in solitary confinement, and no member of their families have been allowed to see them. More than 50 journalists have been forced to go into exile because of persecution and threats. I cannot accept this prize for myself. It belongs to the independent media in my country, to the men and women who have shown incredible courage, risking their safety and freedom to keep the Nicaraguan people informed. I thank the opportunity I have to appeal to you to not forget what's going on in Nicaragua. The Ortega government, at the first sign of popular defiance, dropped all pretense of fairness and ethics and turned its guns against an unarmed population that took to the streets, first to protest a reform to a social security law, but then to reject the repressions and killings with which the government responded. More than 325 people, mostly students, had been killed since April. More than 600 people had been jailed and accused of trumped-up terrorism charges, and more than 30,000 Nicaraguans have fled to neighboring countries, mostly Costa Rica. We need your sympathy, your voices, and your empathy. Our brave journalists are beginning to set shop in neighboring countries or in clandestine locations. We are rooting for them, and I hope you do too. I thank Oxfam Novib and PEN for this prize that honors the work PEN Nicaragua has been doing on behalf of freedom of expression, and that honors me as a writer who keeps believing against all odds in the power of the word. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gioconda Belli. And to introduce now Eelco Bosch van Rosenthal, journalist, he will have a nice chat with you. Please take a seat. And give him a warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, sorry. Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and a pleasure to interview you. We have about 15 minutes, and ahead of this occasion, you told me that it would not be rude if I interrupt you, because if I don't, you keep going on. Those are her own words, so if I do, I have permission.
You're forgiven in advance.
Right, exactly. Congratulations on the award. I don't think you need the encouragement, because even without this award, you're continuing to fight. But I hope it helps.
Yes.
You talked a little bit already about the situation in Nicaragua and how April 18th changed everything. On a scale from a full democracy and a full dictatorship, what path has Nicaragua gone through over the past year?
Well, we weren't in a full democracy. Mm-hmm. Actually, what happened was that Ortega took power in 2007. Mm-hmm. Before that, you know, he lost power when we were together, well, the Sandinistas, in 1990. Mm-hmm. And since then, he began clamping on the party in the first place. We wanted more democracy. We wanted him. We did not want him to continue in charge because he had lost the election. We wanted new people, new blood. And he expelled most of us who were critical of his politics. And then he began to try to get back on power. And to do that, he had to do a lot of concessions. he lost all scruples, really, and went to all, you know, I will mention one thing is the, for example, he promised the Catholic Church to ban therapeutic abortion for women that had been a right for women in Nicaragua since the 19th century. And then he went on to have an alliance with this very corrupt politician so that in exchange for positions and places in the National Assembly, he would allow the percentage to be elected president in a first round to go from 45 to 35%. And then he came to the presidency. And he began to control everything. Control to, he began to put loyal people in the Supreme Court, in the Electoral Council. He began to change the laws in the army so that he could, the person he put in could stay for longer than they were supposed to.
Just textbook dictatorship, basically, putting your pawns everywhere.
Also, they had a lot of money from Venezuela, and he didn't pass it through the, you know, the national budget.
I guess that's why I started. I began about the full democracy to dictatorship scale. We spoke before about Venezuela, where the humanitarian situation is still a lot worse. But is your country going towards that situation?
Well, I hope not.
But I understand.
But they are following the, it's like the same script.
Right.
You know, they get to a point where all the even the elections in Venezuela, they have an electoral system that is very, they can do a lot of tricks. But in Nicaragua, our electoral system was wiped out by Ortega practically. We do not, we could not have free and fair elections anymore. In 2016, there was a lot of abstention. He got re-elected, even though the constitution did not allow re-election. And the last time, not only did he get re-elected, but he elected his wife as vice president.
Right.
That has only happened in a what is the very famous program in
House of Cards.
House of Cards.
Right.
That's the only other place.
That show eventually ended, so maybe that's the good news. No, I wanted to bring her up because she's his wife and vice president, and obviously his most loyal supporter. In situations like this, I guess the second most loyal supporter is always the military, because if you lose the support of the military, you're gone. Is that the case for Nicaragua as well, or does he still have, for one reason or the other, a particular power base, no matter how small, within the people?
Well, he has a small power base, but you know, basically what he did, the army supposedly has been on the sidelines, but really he has armed the police and a paramilitary force.
The military right now is basically on the sidelines.
Supposedly, that's what they say, but you know, we have seen war weapons in the hands of the police and in the hands of this paramilitary people who went out and were the ones who were in charge of putting down the rebellion and killed indiscriminately. And they used a lot of sharpshooters, and they shot students mostly at the beginning, especially of the revolt, from here to here. I mean, there were some that were shot right in the forehead. You know, so it was, that was what got people completely outraged, and it was an incredible expression of disgust at what the government was doing, and the whole country rose up, and so, and it, you saw a turn of, some people were before happy about some of the things that Ortega was doing, you know, because they did some good things, good social programs, you know, with the money that Venezuela had given them.
Even though the protests in April last year started with protests against
the reform
social programs.
Yeah, because, you know, what they did was they bought votes, really. They would give people, like, roofing materials, not really changing the productivity of the society or trying to make people be better, but it was more like a charitable kind of thing that would get them beholden to them, you know, to be more obedient. And now their base is the people who are working in the state, for example, state employees, people who depend a lot of the
But that's
money.
Still a particularly small, small group.
Let's
talk about the people that we are here to celebrate on occasions like this, the independent voices, journalists, writers, etc. There have been many arrests. There have been many news outlets closed. I suppose the only ones that are still open are the state, the pro-Ortega side. What is left of independent journalism in Venezuela, and how do you still operate?
Well, I operate because I believe that I have a little bit of protection because of, you know, people like me in Nicaragua.
Because of your fame.
And no, because I have been outspoken, so I don't know, but I don't know really. The truth is that
being outspoken in a country like, in a regime like this, how is that helpful? How does that protect you? Because it sounds dangerous to be too outspoken.
Well, because I think they are afraid that if they do something to me or to people like me and other, you know, Nicaragua is a very interesting thing because we have a hero, it's a poet, Rubén Darío. That's our hero. Yeah. And so the Nicaraguan people love poetry with a passion. And so poets are revered in Nicaragua. You know, I used to go out in the city before now, and if the police would stop me and they would see my license and...
You would not get a ticket?
No, I would not get a ticket.
That's fantastic. I wish they had that here.
There was a policeman that used to stop me and say, it's an honor for me to stop you.
Wow. So there's some good news within the...
No, but you know, I don't know.
No.
The truth is I feel...
But you felt good to move back because you were in the U.S. for a while and you moved back to Managua.
Yes, in 2013.
Right.
I was longing for Nicaragua all the time. And I went to Nicaragua very often. Mm-hmm. But really...
So you feel safe?
No.
Safe enough to stay?
No, I don't feel safe. I don't know.
Safe enough not to
leave?
What
I feel is that whatever protection I think I have to use it. Mm-hmm. I have to speak. Mm-hmm. I have to be the voice. Mm-hmm. And as long as I can, I will keep doing it because somebody has to do it, you know?
A particular outlet, one of the biggest ones, Confidential, which was a weekly, I believe. Well, it's online, so I guess it's daily. They closed it last month. But I read a couple of articles you wrote for Confidential, which means that in some way they are still around.
They're operating in a clandestine way.
From where?
From different places, you know.
I expected that.
Yes. and it's, you know, we don't know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. Because they totally took everything away from the... We need a campaign to raise funds, to be able to give them more equipment, you know. Somebody can help us here. Will be. But you know,
you can get something published if you want online. I mean, it's obviously
a dire
situation, but you have a way to reach an audience still.
Yes. I mean, and also social media.
Right.
Also what I do is a lot of tweeting, a lot of Facebook, you know, so that way we get, it's interesting because in Nicaragua people do have cell phones. Mm-hmm. And that has been an incredible way to get through to people and to create,
particularly
to maintain
the younger
community.
Generation or everyone?
Yes, the younger generation. Especially, yes.
Mm-hmm. Another thing happened, I think only a few weeks ago, is that one of the a very prominent Supreme Court judge, who was always an ally of Mr. Ortega for years, and he turned against him. Is that an important event, and can it mark a change?
Yes, it is. I mean, I think something is going to give, you know, because Ortega mm-hmm. has been doing so many things that are so intolerable for people. Like, for example, we are now forbidden to go out on the street. Mm-hmm. If, you know, I went...
At night or in general? Or to protest?
No, we cannot protest.
Right.
We cannot protest. And we don't go out at night, really, because the paramilitaries go out. We are really in a state of siege, you know, mm-hmm. What is it called? Not state of siege, but
state of emergency.
Yeah, well, it's a very dangerous mm-hmm. kind of situation mm-hmm. where you don't know when they can take you to jail, mm-hmm. I forgot what you were asking.
What about Mr. Solis, the Supreme Court judge?
Oh, the Supreme Court. He
turned against Ortega and basically predicted a civil war. Is that an important moment that we should
I don't
mark?
Think there will be a civil war because people have been very disciplined in not going out and doing anything armed. You know, the people have been rebelling peacefully, and that mm-hmm. is a very important change in Nicaragua's history. Mm-hmm. And so it's also painful, it's more difficult, because you're really just getting attacked, you know. But at the same time, I think that stance is what got somebody like Solis, you know, had to react. Mm-hmm. Because when you see people being taken to jail, when you have seen people being killed, mm-hmm. when you see all this injustice, then some people react, you know, there is something in people that tends to react, and we are hoping, and I am hoping, and Solis was despicable, you know, he facilitated mm-hmm. a lot of things that Ortega did to get control of the whole country.
Yeah, like getting rid of term limits.
Yeah, exactly.
That was one
term
of the
limits,
things.
And he was...
So was it a very selfish, without getting too much into the weeds of this case, but was it, why did he turn against Ortega for very... particular reasons, possibly?
Well, because he also had a Sandinista past.
Right.
He also was in the resistance inside Nicaragua. Mm-hmm. He was, you know, he probably had a little bit of soul left.
Mm-hmm. A little bit, yeah. And what else do you get? I mean, how many many souls are broken, obviously. Where do you get your hope? Is that for other prominent figures like Solis to turn against him, or is it the younger generation who you say you reach by social media? I mean, where do you get your hope from? Because this has been going on for a while and things are not getting better.
I get my hope from the same thing that began all of this. Before the 18th of April, Nicaragua seemed to go, I thought I'm going probably to die, and the Ortegas, one of the children, because we were so trapped by the situation. And all of a sudden, the whole situation changed, you know, and people are so strong in Nicaragua. And I think something is going to give, because Ortega is getting a lot of sanctions. The OAS wants to apply the Democratic Charter.
The Organization of American States,
which would prevent him from getting new loans. The economic situation of Nicaragua is going to get very difficult for Ortega, and I think that is going to bring with it also more protests. And you know, there comes a point where life is not as important anymore, really. Mm-hmm. And you know, we have seen that in history mm-hmm. many times when people decide, we'll do it, you know, we'll do it whatever the cost.
So basically, in a way, even though April 18 started a bloody period, it may also, in hindsight, in a while, may have been a turning point, in a good way.
Well, the way I see it...
Or is that too simple?
The way I see it is Nicaragua has been a country that has fought against tyranny. Mm-hmm. Fighting against tyranny cost us a lot of dead people, you know, like 50,000 people died in the fight against Somoza, then in the fight against the Contras. And I think that spirit of saying no more, we do not want another dictatorship. We are not going to wait 45 years to get rid of this guy who has become a dictator. And so people are determined to change that situation. And it's going to go, you know, it's going to move slowly, I think, but I don't think we are going, not too slowly.
I think that's a good, sorry, I think that's a good way.
I am an optimist.
You sound like one, and I think that's needed. Thank you so much, and I invite you to go read
a poem.
You can do that over there. And before that, I want to give have everybody give you one more round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Well, this is a poem I wrote recently, and it's called Poesía en tiempos de crueldad. En la noche, una mujer se levanta de puntillas, camina en la oscuridad hacia el balcón volcado sobre el cielo. En la noche, duerme el barrio a su lado. Los sueños de los vecinos flotan sobre los tejados. Las figuras de esperpentos y duendes se mezclan con los gatos y las aves nocturnas. El pecho de la mujer es una fragua que arde con la leña del día. Está llena de humo y el humo le saca las lágrimas. La mujer grita, abre la boca y sale de ella la tormenta. La mujer grita, ¿qué puede hacer la poesía? ¿Qué puede hacer la poesía? ¿Qué hacer con el hervidero de palabras que la habita? Las palabras suaves y las palabras duras, las palabras esas que se han venido haciendo, urdiendo, cavando, revoloteando, revolviendo, revolucionando. ¿Qué puede hacer la poesía con la revulsión? ¿Cuántas palabras amontonar para el asco? ¿Cuántas para el dolor? En la noche, en la cama, ella escucha las voces de la mujer, del hombre, lamentándose. Llora sin llorar. Llega un momento en la vida en que se llora por dentro, para adentro. Después busca al marido entre las sábanas y hace el amor. Pero el amor se queda entre sus piernas, pegado a su piel. Igual que la poesía, se queda dormida sobre el papel. ¿Qué puede hacer la poesía para convertirse en libertad, en cielo abierto? La poesía dormida sobre el papel es igual que las palabras que se escriben para que nadie las comprenda. Es menester el ojo para que la poesía se levante y ande. Es necesario el tiempo, el amor y el horror para que la poesía se encienda como una lámpara y salga con sus fósforos y luciérnagas a iluminar la noche. Con el ojo y la luz, nada es imposible para la poesía. En medio de la ciudad quebrada, los heridos por la muerte y por la vida cantan. La mujer los oye, oye el ritmo antiguo de las voces, ve a las mujeres moverse, recostadas las unas sobre las otras, meciéndose al ritmo de las palabras entonadas por todos. La poesía es ese mundo terco y silencioso, es el fervor dicho en voz baja, es el alma que habla y no se da por vencida. Gracias.
Thank you, Gioconda Belli, for those beautiful poetic words on poetry. Thank you, Radna Fabias, Rajmohan, Roberto Saviani, Dareen Tatour, Alderman Robert van Asten, Michiel Servaes, Jennifer Clement, Eelco Bosch van Rosenthal, Tom van der Lijnkruis. Of course, this is the official opening of Writers Unlimited, so we will be drinking, laughing, maybe dancing, we will be merry, not only because it is the official opening of Writers Unlimited, but also, and especially because it upsets the oppressors, and we should always, always annoy the tyrants. So go have fun and get drunk and everything. Thank you very much.